Welcome, everybody. Thank you for being here on a Friday afternoon. This is our Fall Ivy Hour. Ivy, of course, stands for the Initiative for Vocational Inquiry, and we are made of four interlocking programs: VISO, which is the Interdisciplinary Minor in Vocation, Ethics, and Society; CEL, which is Community Engaged Learning; Wellspring, whose director is here. Will you stand up? This is Lori Galambos. She's our new director of Wellspring and 1C1C, and the Center for Career Education. These four programs are aiming at helping students figure out what they want to do with their lives and forming them in relation to the public good. So we're very pleased to have Dr. Jason Rosenberg with us. He's going to spend an hour talking with us about his life and his work and how the two intertwine and diverge. And we're looking forward to that talk. It's not a standard lecture, so we won't do questions and answers at the end unless Dr. Rosenberg invites that. So thank you for being here, and we welcome Dr. Rosenberg.
I think I've been to every single one of these Ivy Hours because I find it such an incredible opportunity to learn about my colleagues and to see what their life is like, especially as someone who is new here. And every single time, the speaker will take a chronological approach through their life. And so I decided to do something similar, but with a twist. And I have notes, so forgive me for my notes. I hope that's okay. Act one. My life has always been shaped by music. My great uncle was a professional composer. My grandmother, on my mom's side, was an opera singer. She was trained at Juilliard. My grandmother on my father's side, my father's mother, was an organist. And my mom played the piano. And I grew up with the piano in the house. And things went differently, though, with me a little bit, because I started playing the piano when I was young. And my parents apparently, I don't remember this, but my parents apparently said it was so bad that they decided to sell the piano.
Oh, no.
So I was off to a great start in my career in music. From there, my first memories, I have a really, really poor memory of childhood. Like, I barely remember anything before age of 10. It's really kind of astonishing. My sister remembers almost everything. I remember almost nothing. But one of my first memories that I have is of me being in kindergarten and having to go to music school and having to sing songs. And we had to sing She Loves You by the Beatles. And we had to do it so that we sang alone. We had to go down the line and everyone had to sing the melody and you were on the spot. And I remember it was such a nerve-wracking experience. Like, I had to sing in front of everyone. And even though I love the song, my parents were obsessed with the Beatles. I mean, I was kind of obsessed with the Beatles. I was so nervous, and apparently I did really well, according to my teacher, and I just felt like, yes! And that was one of my very first memories that I have, is music being this, emotionally rich experience that, like, shapes, you know, all your feelings, makes your hands sweat, makes you exuberant when you do something well, and there's a sense that, like, I can do something, and I can do it decently well. Then I also remember one of my first experiences is that music was a form of solace. That Whitney Houston, in particular, I remember listening to this Whitney Houston song, and I remember having just a really hard day. I don't remember what happened, but I remember listening to it, and it was as if, like, everything was just easier. I remember crying while listening to it. I remember just somehow it spoke to me and touched me in a way that very few things did. And that was still one of my earliest memories, is of this Whitney Houston song and me just listening to it, kind of crying and being comforted. I didn't actually start playing an instrument until I was about 11. That was a clarinet. My mom really loved Benny Goodman. I was just talking to Dr. Coker about this yesterday, actually. My mom loved Benny Goodman and swing music and played records, this, and I loved the clarinet in these recordings. So I said, I wanted to be, play clarinet. So I started playing clarinet, and I don't know if anyone you played in middle school or late elementary school bands, but not only is it atrocious, but but also the clarinets are terrible because it's a pretty difficult instrument for small fingers because you have to cover the holes. And if you don't cover a hole completely, it squeaks. And so you're constantly squeaking. And then this is in opposition to the saxophones, just like one row over from you. And all they have to do is hit the fingers down and the pad covers the whole key. And so they like never squeak. And I was so envious that the saxophone sounded so much better than the clarinetist that I quickly switched after just a year or two to saxophone. And then, you know, it's weird how we do that. It wasn't because I love saxophone music more than clarinet music. It wasn't because I wanted to emulate some saxophonists. It was primarily because they just sounded better next to me, you know? And so I decided to play saxophone, and I got quite into it. And I actually practiced, rare thing. But I practiced and I felt like I rose the ranks really quickly. And by the time I was in high school, I was like pretty serious into saxophone. And then I became, like my musical life just exploded. I just became integrated with all kinds of musical activities. So I was in band, of course. I quickly became one of the leaders of the high school band and became a drum major. I was in the jazz band. We actually had a pretty good jazz band, and I was one of the leaders of that. But then I also began trying to play and rock and punk music, and bought a really, really, really cheap guitar that would go out of tune instantaneously. Like, no matter how many times you tuned in, no matter what you did, it was going to go out of tune. And I had this incredibly cheap amp. I don't even know how I picked it up, but I got some really cheap amp, and I formed a band with my next-door neighbor, or neighbor down the street, who's my best friend. And we both bought really cheap guitars and cheap amps, and we just started making songs together. And that was in ninth grade. And then it began, we called our band Spoon. This was before a band would become famous named Spoon. It was not us. But we had this band called Spoon, and then we formed a bunch of other bands, and soon we began, you know, actually writing songs and writing things that sounded reasonably good. And it became clear that music could act as a form of expression. Like, I could use music to express myself in ways that weren't available to me in any other capacity. So I was writing songs, a lot of songs, especially really bad punk songs mostly, but still songs with just, you know, like three chords over and over and over again, or maybe four. Maybe we would like get like some chord we didn't know yet. You know, it's very excited, you know, like because we didn't know what we're doing. It was just trial and error. You put your finger on it, like, oh, that's cool. And then you try it again and again. Rehearsals were, you know, you can imagine. You just keep playing it over and over and over and over again, hoping that somehow miraculously it was going to improve without actually, you know, trying to tackle anything specific. But I loved it. I loved it. And I was writing all these songs and experimenting. And then it was also a chance for me to enter the world of politics. My parents, my family aren't politically engaged at all. But I began an interest in politics, and music allowed us to express those political and social concerns. We wanted to engage and create change through music, and this is one way. Instead of writing just a bunch of love songs, we're like, well, why don't we write songs about something that mattered, you know, and try to do something with ourselves. Of course, we didn't necessarily do much, but still, we wanted to try, right? And so it was a way of engaging with myself, but also engaging with the world around me. Then by the time late high school comes around, I got a music notation software. It was just a free one. I think it was called, I don't think it was Nightingale, but it was like the equivalent of MuseScore today for those musicians in the room. And It was very simple. Incredibly simple. And it had absolutely no features of any kind that you'd want today. But it basically allowed you to take a mouse, drag a note, drop it into the staff, and then you could play it back with some really poor MIDI sounds. And I would do this. I would just drag and drop, and then, you know, hit space bar, listen to it. It would be awful. And then I would change it, listen to it again, trial and error, one note at a time, modifying it each time as it went along. Because I was learning more and more about how music is put together, but my understanding was really limited. And so this, I just remember spending hours and hours and hours and hours just playing songs until, and changing them little bit until it was something aesthetically pleasing and something good. I was writing for, I had a saxophone octet that just people in my band in my high school, but we all the saxophones, and I was the leader of this, and so I wrote music for them. I wrote notated music, and yeah, it was fun. It was also an indication of my interest in electronic music, because as many people of my generation and younger, I grew up with video games, and my dad and his brother loved video games. I grew up with a lot of video games in the house, and there's a lot of electronic music in video games, and some of these games even were primarily about music and music making, and I love these things. And so it wasn't that far removed from the sonic world of these things. Like, really bad MIDI isn't that different from, like, you know, 4-track and 8-track music that I was, like, exposed to. And this kind of plays in a little bit later. Then I go to college. I went to a college called New College of Florida. It's in Sarasota, Florida. And all of a sudden, I learned about music theory for the first time. I had some exposure, especially in jazz bands, as you know, you have to improvise and you have to know chord structure, what notes are in a chord and things, but I didn't really understand how those things were put together, how they function, why one chord would follow the next, or why I could pretty much segregate anything, but I didn't know why one note would follow the next. There was no reason to. It just seemed like magic, you know, like it just worked somehow. And all of a sudden I was in these music theory classes and intro music classes in college, and all of a sudden things started to fit and things started to make sense, and music became a lens not only into an understanding how everything works, but also into space and time, because it was also as being exposed to music of different eras. And I started learning about music history. I remember this one, when my very first week of college, my music theory teacher, his name's Stephen Miles, I know some people in the room know him, and he takes a chronological approach. And so he started with plain chant and monophony, and I remember we got to, maybe it's the second week, and we got to Leonin and the Paris school and this music from the 1400s, 1300s, and 1300s, 1200s? I don't even know. 1200s, and like 1250-ish, I think. And it was music I've never, ever heard of before. It was so wildly different. It's the way of organizing, the way of thinking about music, how it's put together, the sonic world in which it lived was so utterly different than anything I had been exposed to, that all of a sudden, instead of reading, and the more I did this, the more it was that instead of just reading about history as being these dates and, you know, this event happened then, this event happened here, that everything kind of took place within like a musical framework and understanding, you know, like, and every time even to this day, when I hear a date, I'm like often putting it in a musical context. It was like shaped how I understood history and the past and the present, really, and what we're doing today. How does that relate to past times? And it all seems so much more integrated and connected in such a meaningful way. And this is one of the reasons I still think taking history courses is so incredibly useful, because it really does shape how you think about world today. But also space, because I was also being exposed to music from all over the world. And music was again this avenue, this lens through which I can understand my place, not only through history, but also around the world and through different cultures and different perspectives. And it was incredibly important to me. And I remember it was, you know, as someone who was pre-YouTube generation and all those mm-hmm. things, that I didn't have much access to these things. And it was, every time I was exposed to it, I felt, you know, the what? Mm-hmm. This exists, and how does, what do we do? How does that relate to it? How do I make sense of this? And how can I interact with that? And, you know, how does that shape who I am? What is, how does my identity gonna change because of this new insight or exposure? In college, I also was exposed to experimental music. There was something called New Music New College that was a new music and experimental music series that began while I was a student there. And I was lucky enough to be there for the very first years of it and could take part in it and help organize it. And through this exposure to experimental music and new music, I learned that music can often be unpredictable and aleatoric. Music that allowed many different possibilities, many different outcomes, and that a lot of the structures of music that we were interested in dealt more with process than product. And this was very different from how I was creating music, right? Every note was meticulously made, you know, and every chord, you know, scrutinized over. And here's this new process, this new way of dealing with the construction of music that allowed chance, that allowed improvisation, and that in a way that wasn't just a moment-to-moment melody thing, but a larger structural component that radically shifted how I thought about what music is. And that would have a massive impact on my life going forward. Then I went to this college that was only 600 students, smaller than Millsaps. And I was the only music major for two of my 4 years there. And the music offerings were very limited. And so I was very eager to get more advanced courses and different types of courses. And so I went to the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, for a semester. And there, that was my first time where I completely and totally devoted myself to music. I took only music courses, almost exclusively graduate level courses. I pretty much lived in either the music building or actually at my professor's house. My professor's name was Herbert Grun. He was an 88-year-old German, and his students were called brunettes. And I was a brunette. Very much so. I thought his takes on music making and experimentalism and all these things were not only radical but incredibly provocative. And he had a composing room in his house, which is almost on campus, where every inch of all the walls were filled with photographs of composers. And he allowed me to use that space whenever I wanted. And so I would go there twice a week and sit there and write my music. And eventually, him and his partner invited me to move in and just live there with them because they had extra space. And it would save me on rent and everything else. And I was like, great, yes, I'll do it. And so I was then living with this composer. And so not only was I completely immersed in the world of music then, I was, you know, literally living in the composer room, surrounded by all these composers, great and trivial alike. And it was the first time in my life that I felt like a professional. You know? Finished New College, then I went to graduate school. I went to the first school, the school of my choice, which was University of California, San Diego. And I chose it because it was the school that most intimidated me. Mm-hmm. People there just seemed so incredibly smart, but also it was a school that was 110% devoted to contemporary music. The only school like it in the country. In fact, when you get a doctorate there in performance, let's say, music performance, you get a doctorate in new music performance. Every single thing about it is devoted to contemporary music. It is almost, you don't, when you walk down the music hall there, you don't hear any music before 1950. Like, you don't hear Chopin and Beethoven, things of this thing. Like, the earliest music you might hear is like Stravinsky. And I love that. As one of my friends described it, he said, musically speaking, it's the closest place in America to Europe. And there was something, it exposed me to this very modernist way of writing music. It was very much European modernism in that there was a sense of we needed to push music forward, and like there's this sense that what came before us should influence us and we should carry that going forward. And that there was an imperative, like a civil and philosophical imperative that we do this. And if we didn't, then we were being irresponsible. And this was kind of the mentality of that school. And to be honest, it appealed to me. Like, I was one of those people that wanted to write music that everything was, you know, every note related to this one little kernel in the whole piece, and that it was all perfectly unified. And these notions that were very much indebted to music that of composers not long before me. And so I very much fit into that school of thought, but it really exposed me to these ideological differences within the community. I'm gonna zoom along now a little bit faster. I realize I'm going too slow. I wanna get through everything. So I was lucky enough to win a bunch of awards this time. I got really lucky, I think. And I applied to a bunch of things, and I got a bunch of things. I won a bunch of these awards, and I couldn't believe it. And I just, like, I was like on like the Midas touch moment in my life, where it seemed like everything I was applying for was getting, and I was just so much success, and I was feeling more confident than I ever had before or since, for that matter. And I was incredibly productive, but I was also ambitious. I was very interested in large-scale forms, sparked by, I don't know how many people know the director Robert Altman, but he wrote these large, he directed these large movies, Nashville and Shortcuts, and these movies would spark kind of a narrative form that I called spiral narratives, where there's kind of a multi-linear approach to narrative structure in these movies. And I call them spiral narratives because they typically have a huge ensemble cast. They're like 3 hours long, and there's like these different narratives that go on. And as the movie continues, you see that there's more and more connections between these narratives, more and more interrelationships, until usually there's one point when everything comes together. Like in Nashville, it's the scene near the end of the movie where it's at a concert, and like everything comes together this moment. And so I almost imagine it like a, like, you know, if you ever go to like a science museum and you drop those like pennies in the spiral thing, and it goes around and around and around and then it falls. I kind of imagine like that, where it's everything is kind of only loosely connected, but then as it goes running around and there's this moment where everything comes together and everything speeds up in terms of the narrative interconnectedness. And the other examples are like Iñárritu's films like Babel and Amores Perros and Crash, and there's a lot of films that do this now. And I was really interested in these, and I wanted to create music like that. And I didn't think that there was many compositional approaches like this, and I was really interested in trying to create that. It allowed me to focus on counterpoint, creating like different melodic characters, as it were, and allowed them to interact in various ways. And my pieces tend to be very long. I wrote, you know, like my first several pieces in grad school were all over an hour, and I was really interested in this large form, which got me interested in the perils of large scale form, and because it's really hard to not only write it, but also to put it on performance wise, to get performances of it, and to the challenges as a listener for such a large piece, especially large complex piece. And I began studying that conceptually, how to problems and pros and cons, advantages, disadvantages, and the perils of large scale structures. I also began my interest in the evocation of historical models, so using older music as direct inspiration in my own compositional practice. And so these two things, these two approaches, kind of dictated my aesthetic world at the time. Then I worked on my dissertation, which was writing a book of madrigals, and I could do that anywhere, and so I was living abroad, but I needed to make money. You know, that's what you kind of have to do, right, to survive. And soon I stopped working very much on my dissertation, and I was taking more and more and more freelance work for money. So a lot of compositional work, but as a freelancer. And that was really hard, and it was a real challenge, but it also allowed me to approach composition with a lot more diversity. You know, instead of just writing for these exclusive, you know, incredible high-end performers that could pretty much play anything you put in front of them, all of a sudden I was getting commissions from amateur choirs, and from, you know, the soloist here or there, or music for a science experiment, or whatever it might be. And I had to find ways of doing this, and doing it with integrity and creativity, but also for a much more simplistic, straightforward kind of musical language, and how to balance that approach and still be true to myself and all those things. It was a real challenge, but on the other hand, I wasn't really doing what I should have done a long time ago, which was my dissertation. For a while, though, I kind of decided I was going to be a freelancer for a while anyway, professional composer, right? And do this anyway, and so I wanted to do the dissertation, but it was just lingering and became more and more a weight on my shoulder that I was very eager to get off. But I began living all over the world at this point, doing these things. I mostly Switzerland, but also Germany and Austria. I taught in Singapore, and before that I was in Cambodia. And music was one of those unifiers for me, right? Composition and how I interacted with the local ensembles and what I was doing. It acted as a form of connection between all these disparate places. It was very important to me. And yeah, and I think that diversity and that interest in a broad perspective manifests itself today in my activities, because my activities now are quite diverse. I still write music for elite ensembles. I'm writing more and more pieces for amateur groups. I also do music, experimental music with my ensemble Meme, for instance, and director of that group that's focused on these experimental approaches I mentioned earlier. And then I do music, research on music in the brain, and very involved in those things. So I have a very diverse input, and I think a lot of my background has led me to that diversity. Act two. My life has always been shaped by math and science. My mom is a math teacher, was a math teacher, she's retired now, but she was a math teacher, and I grew up with math being a constant force in the household, and always asking my parents to give me harder and harder math problems, and it feels really, I debate whether I should say it, I have been debating actually whether I should say it or not, but I feel really embarrassed to do it, but I was kind of a math prodigy when I was young, and I was very gifted. I was many grades ahead, and when I was young, I was always one of these kids that had to like sit in the back of the room with just the textbook and couldn't, you know, participate in the rest of class. I was given my own material, or I was just put in a different classroom several grades ahead, and yeah, this led to things like me going to high school and have already done a year of calculus, and so then I did my second year of calculus, I think my freshman year, and then the rest of my years were just spent either, I think my sophomore year was spent doing differential equations and things, it's just in the back, again, back of the room with the textbook, and then the rest of the time was just spent in college, where I was allowed to go to college in high school. But also, I was really invested in science. I was doing science projects a lot, like many people in middle school, and you know, all those typical kinds of things. I just loved it. I was doing a lot of it. I was also like a science camp counselor during summers, where we'd travel all around Florida looking at different things and studying science, but I was just one of the helpers with that. My parents and family would always give me gifts that related to science. Mm-hmm. Like, everyone knew I loved science and math, and so that's like, it became like your identity, right? You know, once they know that you like something, then it's like everyone in your family knows it, and so that's all they do is give you those things, which only self-perpetuates this like interest. And I was also obsessed with space camp. I loved going to these things, and it was basically through math and science the world made sense to me. This is how like I try to make sense of the world. And I went to an IB school, an international baccalaureate school, where you choose three upper level subjects, and that, without surprise, was math, physics, chemistry. I don't think music was even an option. In fact, I know music wasn't even an option, but those were my three interests. I remember my chemistry teacher asked me if I took 3 years of chemistry and in high school, and was on my upper levels, and I remember my chemistry teacher and I, he asked if I'd like to work with him on a project where we try to invent sunscreen, work on improving sunscreen technology so that when you apply it, there'd be a visible layer, and then it would slowly become transparent. And I remember that was like a big project of mine in high school, was working with them and trying to improve the technology that did that. So I was really interested in actually applying this material, and I was obsessed with cosmology. My favorite books at the time were all about black holes, about early universe, about birth and life of the stars and solar system, and I think Dr. Bruhn can relate to these things. And I applied for college as an aeronautical engineer. I wanted to do rocket science and nuclear physics. And I, that's what I applied to college for, and that was my intent. I had enough math and science credits from all the AP and IB course I took that I basically already had like a math minor by the time I entered college. And so I did a music and math thing, thinking that math, I wasn't sure what the role math was going to play, math and physics and chemistry. What role was that going to play in my life? And so I wanted that to be an integrated part of my college experience. So I did a kind of a dual math music approach. And thinking that even if I went into music, I could still always have math as a safety net, right? Because it's obviously a safer field to go into. And so having a degree, I thought, would really help me. When I entered college, I totally embraced my geekiness, as I still do. And throughout all around my dorm room walls, there were posters of deep space posters, and life cycles of stars, and, you know, like information, like posters, you know, like educational posters and all these things. And I just love that stuff. And so at my college, it's a tradition that everyone gets a nickname, because there's only 600 students, so everyone gets a nickname, and my nickname that my classmates gave me was Star. And to this day, there are people that I know that do not know my real name. They only know me as Star. Some of them joke with me and call me Starship or Starship Enterprise, all these things. But yeah, I was obsessed with cosmology, and that was my plan. I was actually, when I first went there, I was planning on starting out at this small school so I could take these, you know, have this personalized experience, but then quickly transfer after like 2 years to a larger research university. It didn't happen that way. I just stayed where I was, and I focused more on music, but that was not the plan at first. I did a dissertation that combined music and math based on the four color theorem, which is a really important kind of cornerstone theorem in graph theory. And I related that theorem and theoretical understanding to a composition that I created that was based on a similar thing that deals with boundaries, because that's ultimately what the four color theorem deals with, as well as relationships and boundaries, and so my piece dealt with that as well. And so it kind of combined math and music in a very interesting, unusual way. I went to grad school just in music composition. But my second year in grad school at UC San Diego, I got an email from a neuroscientist at a neighboring institute called the Neurosciences Institute. He said that he was looking for an assistant for a project he's working on involving music and the mind. And I applied, he selected me, we worked together, the project went great, and he said, you know, that was really fun, and you were quite an asset, would you like to be a permanent research assistant for me? And I thought about it, because I wasn't sure, because it didn't give me any credit towards my degree. It was a different institution. It in no way reflected what I was going to do with my degree or probably my life. But I decided yes, in part because I needed money too, right? Like, it was another job, and we all look for other jobs in grad school, right, to help pay the bills. And so I was like, well, it's like a good, stable, like 10 to 15 hour a week job. It's interesting work. Doesn't pay very much, but it is cool. And so I just started doing that. And his name is Anirudh Patel. He's now like one of the big names in the field of music and language and the brain. And I was just incredibly lucky to be under his wing for so many years. I was working with him for 3 or 4 years and became like the music guy at the Neurosciences Institute. Yeah. So if anyone had a music question at this science institute, they would ask me. And so then I became involved in more and more projects. I became an author in some of these projects. And then that allowed me to be known outside of the region. And so then I was being asked to be involved with projects that were taking place at Harvard, and then at University of Maryland, and then eventually like around the world, and the Netherlands, and in Switzerland, and blah, 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 blah. So I was being more and more sought after as a sort of incredibly niche market, right, of doing composition and being a professional musician that actually knows a decent amount about the science. And so yeah, and now to this day, it's part of my life when I wasn't expecting of it, so it's still influencing who I am and what I do today. Act three, my life has always been shaped by exploration. My dad was born in Vienna, he's Austrian, but was raised mostly in Canada. When he was in late high school, he moved to the US, eventually went to Florida, met my mom and me, but his international upbringing, I think, was in large part for his constant desire to travel and to explore. My mom's a teacher, my dad owned a business, and so they were able to travel a lot. And so when I was a kid, we traveled every summer. We would always go on some huge vacation, and during winter, we would always go somewhere. So many months a year would spend either on the road, in a van, or in a cabin somewhere, or on a cruise ship, or in some other country, or whatever it was. And so that was always part of my life. But another part of my life that deals with this was, I don't really remember this at the time, but apparently the thing that my whole family complains about when they talk about my childhood was that I had an incessant inquisitiveness. I was obsessed with the word why. And I would never let anything go. You know, I'd always want to know why. And I was just interested in everything. Those that know me now, they probably know that it's still a trait that I notice with. But especially at the time, I think even when I was quite young, I strived to see and find the beauty in everything and everyone. And I was like, no matter what it was, whether it was like the fabric of a seat or the shape of a lampshade or, how wide glasses should be or how the distance of the lanes in a street and how that affects how fast or slow you perceive you're going. And all these kinds of things. Like there's almost no topic that I'm not totally interested in, and which leads to a problem. I remember when I was young, my parents said that every year for my birthday, I had a wish when I blew out the candles, and that wish was that I wouldn't need to sleep, so I could have 8 more hours a day to do things. Exploration also came through sports. I was quite a jock as well, and I loved playing in all kinds of sports. But the one I excelled in most, for weird reasons, was golf. And I was, for a time, I was considering going professional in it. I was very competitive on at least a regional level. And the first time I went to Europe when I was 13 was on a golfing scholarship. I was on the American Youth Golf Team, and I was pretty into it. And I also, in high school, began interest in activism through the music I already mentioned, like trying to create change through our punk bands. And but also, I watched this movie 7 Years in Tibet, and it's funny how these things happen, right? It was just a movie. But I never heard of Tibet before. Like, it was totally unknown to me. And I wanted to know more. It seemed like a terrible human catastrophe, what was happening, at least as portrayed by the movie. And so I wanted to do research. And it was just at the time when that Tibetan freedom movement was really, coming to. And so I was part of that early wave that began a real interest in it and started a group of Students for Free Tibet, a chapter for Students for Free Tibet. And Tibetan causes became, a really, it very much shaped me. I did that throughout college, where I was really working hard on trying to raise awareness of what was happening and have an interest in it and learn more about it. And I raised money to bring in Tibetan monks and nuns to my area to do performances and exhibitions, and it was great because they would always stay at my house. And so sometimes it'd be, 14 monks just in my living room and all in their red robes, one thing you should know about Tibetans is that there's two things that it seems like is a universal thing with Tibetans. There's a lot of things that separate them, but one thing is that they love basketball. They always want to play basketball, and they love Bob Marley. So if you play Bob Marley, they know every Bob Marley song, and they love playing basketball. So that was something we always did every time monks and nuns came over. We always would play basketball with Bob Marley, and so this was in college. In being a college student, you also have summers off, or at least, summers where you get flexible what you did. And so I spent a lot of time abroad and try to maximize those 3 months by often spending those 3 months out of the country. And when I graduated from college, my parents gave me a gift, a plane ticket to anywhere I want in the world. And of course, I knew instantly, obviously, I'm going to go to Tibet. You could have just said a plane ticket to Tibet, it would be the same thing. And so I spent 3 months in Tibet. I really was learning the language. I really wanted to become even more involved. I was, at this point, by the time I went there, I was not only had a chapter, a very thriving chapter of Students for Free Tibet, but I was actually the regional president of that chapter. And I was the president of the whole southeast area, even though I was only 22, and I wasn't Tibetan. I was one of the only non-Tibetans that was involved at that kind of level. but I was totally, I was completely and totally into this. And I also was interested in world music. During my time at University of Illinois, I was involved in the Balinese gamelan ensemble, and I was very active over that. We toured a lot. I spent the summer touring with gamelan, this Indonesian percussion ensemble that, by the way, as a plug, I'll be teaching a course in Bali in the summer for gamelan. So if you're interested in learning Balinese gamelan, come with me next summer. But I also abandoned the saxophone at this time with the idea that if I was going to be a composer, I should learn a whole bunch of instruments and not just focus on saxophone. And frankly, I didn't have a lot of time to play and practice. It's actually, it's kind of busy. I kind of invented that with the idea that I was going to learn a whole bunch of other instruments. So I started learning string instruments and trumpet and guitars and drums and, you know, voice. And I was just trying to broaden my approach to my understanding so that I could feel more comfortable writing for each of these instruments. For those that are musicians, young musicians, I don't recommend doing this, but that was what I did. I would not recommend that. That was not, I don't think, a good decision. But it is what I chose at the time with the idea that would be helpful. It was helpful in many ways, but I don't think the advantages outweigh the disadvantages. I was also really interested in seeking challenges. So I think I went to this college in part because it was so different from my experience. It was a hippie school. It had no grades. It was a place that everyone is a left-wing, bisexual, environmentalist, vegetarian, you know, no shoes wearing, like, place, and I totally loved it. But it was also a challenge in many ways, and very different from what I had grown up with. The graduate school I went to was rather extreme in their focus, but also in their mentality and perspectives. And the countries that I most often travel to and have expressed the most interest in my studies or adventures have been developing nations, whether that's Tibet or Madagascar or Cambodia or these other places. Like, that's where I spent the most amount of time, and I've always been attracted to these places. I think in these places and these kinds of experiences, the density of memorable events is highest, and I've always been attracted to seeking out those kinds of things. And I think this is one of the reasons why I'm here at Millsaps, where we all can recognize that Mississippi in some way is kind of like the Tibet of the country, right? It's one of the most financially impoverished but culturally rich, and it allows an opportunity for me to grow and have a large density of memorable events. So that's one of the reasons that I'm here. And I'd say to end this act is that now, ever since the freelance abroad, and which I've been really trying to find ways as an artist and as a thinker, as a scholar, to do more collaborative work. And so I'm trying to do, my exploration is coming through trying to work with others, whether that's with meme and working as an ensemble in the creation of pieces rather than me just dictating, here's the piece, let's do this, but allowing others to have much more control on what we do and the artistic decisions, to collaborating in science and having people like Ani Patel or a host of other collaborators where we do science together, where I might be the music specialist, they might be a neuroscientist specialist, they might be a behavioral scientist specialist, and then often we work all together, so it's not just two people, but like five people, each with their own specialty, each bringing certain things to the table and working together to advance a larger goal. Something that's very common in science, but it's really uncommon in music. And I'm trying to incorporate more of that kind of mentality into the musical domain. Act four, my life has always been shaped by amateurism and indecision. As you see, my interests are really broad. I struggled as a youth and to this day between when I was young, between I was really invested in science, but also sports, also music. I didn't know what I was gonna do or what I was, where I was headed. Yeah, I loved math and science, and I thought I was gonna do that, but I also loved all these other things. And the word amateurism, of course, from many of you know, it comes from Latin, amare, to love. And it's really true that I, in most, you know, Latin-based languages, Romance languages, had something like that today, amore or something. And there's something really true to me about feeling like an amateur. Like, I do love those things, but I also feel like a lot of times my understanding or commitment to them is surface level. And I really struggle with that, especially as a professional now. But even back then, instrumentally, I played the saxophone. But I was also playing in punk bands and rock bands and I would sing and play guitar, but sometimes for some bands I would play saxophone, some bands I would play drums. And nowadays I play keys too. And you know, like, you know, it's almost as if I can't decide what I should be doing in these things. And also I mentioned I was doing all these bands and trying to create, you know, political movement and social response. But these bands sucked. I mean, let's just be honest. We were awful. We were terrible. And, you know, I wanted to present this as like the way as sometimes I do present it, where I'm like, yeah, I was doing all these great things. But it's also very easy to tell the same story and be like, well, every one of these things, you know, I was invested in, but it didn't mean I was good at it. And I struggled with that. You know, I struggled with this sense that, like, I wanted to do more with it, but I was already doing so many things. I had to balance all those things, and feeling that I was producing things, but didn't mean that they were quality. And how to wrestle with that. I think I had this, like, small-town delusion of grandeur at times, right? Where, coming from a small place where nothing was happening, it felt like I was doing something really impactful and meaningful. And of course, now I look back at it and I laugh at the immaturity and the naivete. And in New College, here's a list of some of the things I did. One year during my, every year you have to write a contract that you work with your advisor that says not only what classes you're gonna take, but also your short-term goals and long-term goals, your activities. Something actually I wish that Millsaps did is really useful. And under activities, I was the president of Students for Free Tibet. I was a vice president of Amnesty International. I was a DJ at my radio station. Treasurer for the animal rights group. I was a big brother with the Big Brothers Big Sisters program. And I was in the jazz band. I was in several other bands not related to the school. And yeah, how I managed to do as much as I was doing, it kind of just baffles me. I also had this math music thing, but I always felt that, you know, what would have been if I'd gone down the math? But I chose music. I often wondered what would have been like if I'd gone down the math path, because I frankly was way better at math than I was at music. Like, I was good, like, naturally, like, you know, it was one of these, like, just naturally good at math. And I struggled to be good at music. I wanted to be really good, and I really devoted myself, but I was just, you know, there was a clear, like, one that came easier and one that was hard. And I chose the hard one. And so often in my life have I wondered what life would have been like had I chosen the other one, right? I don't have a good answer for this. There's pros and cons, I see. You know, it's easy to see the advantages and disadvantages. The idea of setting up a hard goal and then, you know, overcoming and fighting really hard and trying to meet these challenges. On the other hand, I sometimes wrestle with the idea that maybe I could have an even larger impact if I had gone into math and science. Because my abilities are greater, perhaps, and that my contributions to society, like, I wonder if it's socially irresponsible in some way, you know? It's something I really struggled with. Now I feel, you know, I've come to terms, and I love the fact that I'm a musician and that I do what I do, but for a long time especially, I really struggled with, like, on a deep level of, is this totally selfish that I'm going to music rather than the thing that I think I'm better at? Like, am I choosing passion over what's better for society? Yeah, it's easy to say, like, follow your passion, but it wasn't so easy, actually. I felt like my passion was not the thing I was best at. So, to this day, I struggle with it, with stylistic indecision. Stylistically, I love so much music and so much art, so many artistic practices and approaches. And I'm someone who has now more or less embraced plurality and a diversity of approaches and techniques, but it's still something I wrestle with. Which leads me to my last, I actually wrote here that I'm really good at trivia. Like, if you ever need, like, someone to, like, do, like, pub trivia with, like, I'm a good guy to have on your team. I know, like, a bunch of things about a lot of topics, but everything seems to, you know, I wonder how much of it is surface level, right? So I still struggle with that, which leads me to perhaps my last one, given the time. Act 5, my life has always been shaped by self-doubt. I grew up with a terrible speech impediment. Part of the reason I was so good at math was because I was so terrible at speaking and reading. I had to go through 8 years of speech therapy. I was really far, far ahead in math, and I was always in, like, another league, but I was behind in school and when it came to reading. And I remember some of my earliest memories also dealt with struggling to talk to people. And when I watched old videotapes of, you know, childhood, family videotapes, it's so hard to watch because I can't understand anything I say. I know I'm talking to the camera, I have no idea what I'm saying. And, you know, it sucked both ways. Like, I struggled with that, as anyone probably would, but then I was also not fitting in with my class because I was, like, in just the back, like, doing math by himself. Like, that's socially awkward. And I felt kind of like an outcast in many ways. I also, unlike my sister, who's like, didn't need any corrective anything, I needed, like, braces, I needed glasses, I had terrible acne. I felt, and I was, like, reasonably social, and I didn't have, like, a terribly oppressive or struggle with it too much, but I really, there was enough things combined that I really wrestled with self-doubt. And that comes through more recent times with musicianship. And being a composer, it's really rare that I started music at age 11. Most professional musicians, they're born and they have, like, a violin in their hand when they come out of the womb somehow. And I felt I was so late to the game. And I still struggle with that, feeling that I have to work so much harder to do those things. My dissertation lasted forever, my PhD dissertation. And that caused me a problem when I got my dream job in Singapore as a professor at a place called Yale NUS. Tenure track job, distant location, amazing resources, Ivy League, everything about it was perfect. And I lost my job. I was asked to resign after a snafu happened where I was supposed to enter with my PhD in hand. Contractually, that was part of the contract. I had defended my dissertation to 2 weeks before I moved there to start my job. But my advisor wanted me to do revisions. That's pretty normal, as many of you know. That's totally normal. No big whoop. And so I went there and they knew and all that, but the contract wasn't changed. And ultimately the Board of Education, Ministry of Education, I should say, of Singapore said, hey, you don't have a PhD yet, and you're supposed to have a PhD. It says it right here. In addition, the school made a biography, and it didn't have, it was ambiguous whether I had it or not. It said, did his graduate studies at UC San Diego. So it's kind of ambiguous whether I had it or not, and I approved their wording. Granted, I was just about done. I had already defended, but after just 9 months there, it was ruled that it was decided by the government that I can't work there because they can't make gray. It's black or white issue. I said I was supposed to have a PhD. I didn't have one. The school appealed it, but ultimately they said no, and so I was forced to leave. So there's been a lot of unexpected twists and turns, a lot of times when I just kicked myself and like, why didn't I just do this earlier? Wrestled with like where I should be and who I am. And so I think I'll end with that, of course I'm out of time, but I'll end with that, with this idea that it's very easy to paint yourself. How we present ourselves, like, there's five different stories, five different paths that each present a different mask on one's life. I think they're all true. In fact, I had others that I thought, I didn't know how long things would take, so I just wrote others down. And that they're all true, and that they all make up who we are. And for those that are younger in the room, I think you accept that there are things that you do that are wonderful, and that you're on a really successful time, but you also feel like you struggle with certain things, and that you go through hardship or a depression or doubt, and that all those things for almost every single one of us is true, that we have all those things simultaneously, and they all contribute to who we are and how we're shaped, and it's just up to us to decide how we present those things